Good morning. We apologize for the technical difficulties and the delay of getting with you this morning, but we are online. Welcome on behalf of our senior pastor, the Reverend Dr. John E. Manzo, to St. Mark's United Church of Christ here in New Albany, Indiana, where no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey or where you're worshiping with us from, you are welcomed here. I am Ken Rose. I am the director of youth ministry here at St. Mark's. And Pastor John is with his family over the Thanksgiving holiday and will be back in the office this coming Tuesday. We have a few announcements this morning before we begin our time of worship. The flowers on the altar are in sponsor of loving memory of Dennis Parr's mother, Mitzi Parr, in remembrance of her birthday, November 30th, by Dennis and Bev Parr. Our worship guide is sponsored this morning in honor of Bill Hook, in celebration of his birthday, December 4th, by his wife, Carolyn. Also, we do not and we're not able to have our poinsettias this year, or poinsettias, so how about purchasing some greenery of some Christmas wreaths instead? They will be on their way here this week, and there's quite a bit that are available. There are 22-inch wreaths that are $25, 28-inch wreaths that are $35, and swags that are $25. If you are interested, please get a hold of Barbara, and she will be able to take care of that for you. A couple other announcements this morning is that I would like to say a thank you to our Board of Elders and to the volunteers who have beautifully decorated our chancel area. We were not able to do our hanging of the greens as we typically would during the year, but they were able to at least have our chancel area decorated and looking good for us this morning while we begin the Advent season. And then I would like for you to do me a favor there at home on Facebook. You're able to put little comments below our video and our live feed. I would like for you to give a shout out and a thank you to two wonderful ladies who we are so fortunate to have here at St. Mark's. And that would be our chairpersons of our Christian Education Committee, May Earle and Katie Barksdale. They have put together a wonderful Advent bags and activities for our church families, particularly for our pre-K to our 12th grade youth and their family. And they put a lot of work and effort into this, and for their love that they have for our congregation, it was just very nicely done, and we were able to deliver those out yesterday. So thank you, Katie and May, for all that you do for us here at St. Mark's. So let us now go to God in time of worship as we prepare ourselves and listen to our beautiful prelude. Thank you. Our call to worship this morning comes from Isaiah chapter 64, verses 1 through 5. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence, to make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down, the mountains quaked at your presence. From the ages past, no ear has heard, no eye has seen any God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who do gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways. Let us worship the one who comes. And our opening hymn this morning, while we are waiting, come.
Good morning. If you'll please join me for the prayer of gathering. God of hope, be with us in our Advent journey to the manger and beyond. Be with us in our meeting and in our traveling together. Be with us in our worship and our praying together. Be with us in our Advent journey to the manger and beyond. Our God of hope.
As our days grow shorter and our nights longer, we who are people of faith turn to symbols such as candles, evergreens, and wreaths to proclaim our belief in that unquenchable light. In hopeful anticipation, we prepare for the coming of the reign of God.
As we begin our journey to the light, we confess that our lives have not always been lived in ways pleasing to God. Our shame has left us feeling distant from the one who is both mother and father to us all, the one in whose hands we are like clay. Yet even now, our longing for the one who tears
heavens and comes down, kindles like a fire in our soul. Even now as we wait, we dare to hope.
We who are pregnant with anticipation feel hope rise up within us. And so we light this first candle and name it hope.
Like to invite all the little ones at home to gather around whatever device you are worshiping with us at home for our children's time. And for those of you young at heart, please be tuned to the message. Well, I don't have much time, so I'm going to dig deep inside this bag of wonder and see what I've got this morning. I've got a planner calendar of the United Church of Christ. I've got a watch. It's a Timex, but it's still not ticking, though. And I'm standing by our Christmas wreath. What does all of these have in common? Ah, I know every one of you there at home is smart. I can hear you through the internet. You said they deals with time, and you are correct. Our calendars have the days and the months. It may not tell us exactly what hour it is, but the watch can tell us. And then we have a wreath, our Advent wreath, with its four colorful candles and the white candle in the middle. And we light these candles for each Sunday leading up to Christmas. It tells us and allows us to see the journey and the waiting during Advent as we count down the time of Jesus' birth and when Jesus comes back again. So during this Advent season, and I know many of you at home have gotten a wonderful Advent package and has activities galore for you during the season, and your own little Advent wreath, a magnet or a paper wreath. Light your candles on Sundays with us here at the church as you journey with us on this waiting. Let's pray. Almighty God, we thank you for the time that we have to do during Advent of waiting for you. Amen. So little ones, until next time, be good and do good. And know that you are loved.
Our scripture readings this morning. The first is from Isaiah 64, verses 1 through 9. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountain would quake at your presence. As when fire kindles brushwood, and the fire causes the water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down, the mountain quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you. You who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you and your ways. But you were angry and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities like the wind take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember our iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. Our second scripture reading is from Psalms 80, verses 1 through 7 and 17 through 19. Give ear, O shepherd of Israel, you who lead Joseph like a flock. You who are enthroned upon the cherubim, shine forth before Ephraim and Benjamin and Manasseh. Stir up your might and come to save us. Restore us, O God. Let your face shine that we may be saved. O Lord God of hosts, how long will you be angry with your people's prayers? You have fed them with the bread of tears and given them tears to drink in full measure. You make a scorn of our neighbors. Our enemies laugh among themselves. Restore us, O God of hosts, let your face shine that we may be saved. But let your hand be upon the one at your right hand, the one whom you gave and you made strong for yourself. Then we will never turn back from you. Give us life and we will call on your name. Restore us, O Lord God of hosts, let your face shine that we may be saved.
Thank you.
Wow. Thank you, Mary. That was beautiful. I think church is done. So, thank you, though. That was absolutely beautiful. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be of one accord and acceptable in thy sight, our Lord, our rock, and our Redeemer. Amen. Now, I don't want to alarm you, but today is the last Sunday of November, which means tomorrow is the last day of the month, and therefore December the 1st is on Tuesday, and that would mean that Christmas is 26 days away. Now, the chances are that this fact has not escaped you. There are numerous ways in which we can count down the days, from functional decor to chocolate-filled calendars, and I just recently saw an advertisement that Aldi's this year has their wine advent calendar, which I'm sure were right off the shelves the moment they were on in light of 2020, to even large place cards in front of the stores that we would typically be running to and fro from during this time of season. But as an adult, this time always seems to accelerate. It seems to go by quickly every year. And that is probably because this is the time where we are full of extra activities and places to be and people to see and things to do. But I recall as a child, oh, like so many children, I remember feeling that Christmas was never going to get here. And then I remember asking my family, my parents, is it Christmas yet? Did Santa come? Christmas could never get here soon enough. And we have entered now, though, into this unique time of waiting. In the church year, this is the season of Advent. It is a time marked by wonder and expectation. It begins on the fourth Sunday before Christmas, and it is a time set apart for the anticipation of the coming of Christ, both the celebration and the commemoration of his first coming with his birth, and the anticipation and the longing for his second coming, which has not yet happened. These two Advents are both marked by the common factors of waiting and anticipation. It is a season in which we ask, how long must we wait? As a sign of our deep yearning for God to be with us. And each time that we ask this question, we voice our faith and join God's people throughout the ages who have longed for God's presence. This is the setting of our scripture text this morning, which began on a more somber note than that of twinkling lights and tinsels and Christmas parades that we are so accustomed to at this time of year. Psalms 80 and Isaiah 64 voice a serious lament and anxiety about the state of the world. I want to say that once more. Psalms 80 and Isaiah 64 voice a serious lament and anxiety about the state of the world. Has that not been our year of 2020? The United Church of Christ theologian Walter Brueggemann says, Advent begins not on a note of joy, but of despair. Humankind has reached the end of its rope. All of our schemes for self-improvement to excavate ourselves from the traps that we have set for ourselves have come to nothing. We have not realized at the deepest level of our being that we cannot save ourselves, and that apart from the intervention of God, we are totally and irreversibly lost. The season thus attempts to capture the spirit of hope in the midst of hopelessness, a spirit of yearning for that which is too good to be true, some new and unique expression of God's intention to save a world gone wrong. Now here at St. Mark's in Advent's past, we have had tremendous ways of worship. Pastor John would typically do a preaching sermon series through the Advent season. We'd have scripts and so forth that would be read during the Advent lighting of the Advent candle. But as Pastor John and the worship team gathered to discuss what we would do for this Advent season, John said, let's keep it simple. Let's look at the lectionary text and let's be traditional. And thus, the traditional theme for the first Sunday of Advent is hope, particularly recalling the hope of the prophets. For Isaiah, we hear in chapter 64, which comes almost at the end of the book, that the Israelites have returned from exile. All should have been restored, but the reality doesn't reflect that. There is still intense oppression and struggle. Life is fraught with challenge. The verses that we heard so beautifully read this morning by Emily are that of a prayer for salvation that expresses two components of Advent hope. On one hand, there is a deep sense of desperation about a situation out of control. And on the other hand, there is a bold and confident trust in a God, in a God that is voiced and addressed, and in a God that can intervene, if so willed, to make life peaceable and joyous. Life without God is unbearable. That is the present tense. But life with God can be completely transformed. And that is the urgent hope of the prayer. And this is not a naive hope or a wishful thinking, but one born out of deep conviction and trust. It is an orientation of the spirit, distinct from optimism, in that it is not a conviction that something will turn out, but certainly that something makes sense regardless of how it turns out. Advent is about this kind of hope, a conviction held even in the face of adversity, made possible only by faith in God. And in a similar way, our scripture text from Psalm 80 voices hope as well. Theologians predict that this was written likely in the northern origin, reflecting a strong interest in divine justice, Israel's history from Exodus to exile and to Zion. The psalm expresses a deep desire to figure God out as the people wait to see God's presence. The psalm gives voice to the grief of the people over the impression that God has disappeared. But rather than remain paralyzed in silence, the psalm gives the voice to move the people from despair to hope. This movement is found in even in our questioning of how long must we wait, that breaks the silence and creates a space for truth-telling and discovery. Questioning of God's purpose that coexists with the affirmation that God is the one who offers salvation and deliverance. United Church of Christ minister Talitha Arnold notes that Psalm 80 is an incredible confession, not of sin, but of faith. It confesses that the people's trust in a God who is big enough to hear their hurts, strong enough to handle their anger and pain. It also identifies the congregation as a people who, even in their suffering, have the courage to call on the Lord God of hosts to help them. Both of these scriptures this morning reminds us that Advent is more than just counting down the days until we get to sing Silent Night and remember a sweet baby in the manger. Advent is about a deep longing for God's presence in our world, one that extends to our lives today, even in the midst of 2020. Advent ushers us into a season of communal prayer and penance, along with the prophet of Isaiah and all of God's people throughout the ages who have had hoped and called out to God to come into their lives yet again. We do this by offering our earnest cries of how long must we wait? How long must we wait until things feel normal again after we have lost a loved one? How long must we wait when someone has lost employment due to the pandemic and is searching for work? How long must we wait to be able to do the things that we love after a surgery or a series of treatments? How long must we wait until a memory is no longer painful? How long must we wait until our pews are overflowing again with the smiling faces of our faith family that we love so much? How long must we wait until the need is gone of something so basic as food and water, and that our soup kitchen can permanently close because the need is no longer there? How long must we wait, O God, until mass shootings and social injustice is absent from our news feeds and television? How long must we wait until troops come home to their families because there is no longer a risk of war? How long, dear God, must we wait for our prayers to be answered? We cry out to God over and over again. And then, as the psalmist does, three times, we ask for God to deliver us from the state that we are in. Rejoice, O God, let your face shine that we may be saved. It is a calling for a blessing, a longing to receive something that only God can offer. It echoes the priestly blessing from Numbers chapter 6, verses 22 through 27. Quote, may the face of God shine upon you in ways that are only possible for those who are in the presence of God. And this request for blessing is both wished and declaration, something that we hope to happen, and something that we already know to be true. This is the posture of living in between the two advents of God's coming. We know God's presence coming to us is within God's ability, and the way God has engaged with the world made manifest in the incarnation of Jesus Christ. And yet, at the same time, it is a hopeful orientation to the world of what is still possible, of trusting that God can, at any moment, break into our difficult and heavy experiences of longing with a fresh vision and presence. Advent is about being bold enough to ask God to do just that. It is an expression of hope, based on a deep-seated belief that what God has done before, God can and will do again. It is about adopting a posture of expectation and anticipation of God bursting onto the scene. It is about watching and waiting, most certainly. But it is also actively engaging in dialogue with God, marked by our hope in what God can do. It is about making the active choice to hope, even when it looks like the cries of how long must we wait? May this be our approach to the next 26 days. Amen. At this time this morning, there are many needs and folks on our hearts to lift up in prayer. We want to remember all of those in our faith family and friends and throughout the world who are suffering, who are dealing with the illness of the pandemic or that of any other illness, that we know that God is the great physician, and we ask God's guiding hand with the nurses and doctors that are there to heal. We pray for those who have lost loved ones, not only to COVID-19, but to all aspects of our lives. We remember particularly the Fleming and Johnson family and the family of Dorothy Brown, who had recently passed away. This morning, though, as we go in prayer, we go first in silence to lift up those items that are in our hearts to God. Let us pray. O merciful God, we come before you this morning, humbly as your people, in all of your wonder. We come to you at the beginning of this Advent season, a time to wait, to anticipate the coming of the Christ child. And we long and anticipate your second coming. And until that time comes, we lift up our prayers and needs to you. We pray for all those who are afflicted with illness and disease. We ask of your comfort and your love and your touch on all of their lives and those that who love and support them, who care for them, for the doctors and nurses and the physicians, all and who you have blessed with knowledge and the touch of healing. We lift up those who have lost loved ones throughout this crisis. For each day that someone has gone on to heaven with you, there are those of us here that mourn and miss them tremendously. Ease our pain, comfort us, allow us to know your presence is always with us. We pray for our church. We pray for the ministries throughout the world as we seek to serve you, to lift up your name. And we ask now, as we join together with all Christians throughout the world and those who have come before us, as we unify together and pray in the prayer that you taught your disciples to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. At this time of the service would be when we would take up our offering to God. And so I encourage our faith members and friends that are watching there at home, that you'll be able to give your tithes and offering through our website, or you can mail a check into the church, or if you're interested in our Simply Giving, where an amount can be deducted monthly, please contact us here at the church and we'll get you that information. If you're worshiping with us from another church, we are glad you're with us, but we encourage you to support with your tithes and offerings your home church so they too can continue the ministry of our Lord Savior, Jesus Christ. And let us now commission one another, which is slightly different, for it is Advent. So let us commission each other. Follow the light of hope's guiding star. Seek the child. Listen to the words of a heavenly host. Find the child. Offer as gifts the best that you have. Serve the child. Peace be among us. God be with us. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning, Comfort, Comfort Ye My People, from the Chalice Hymnal number 122, from our minister of music.
Of the peace that waits for them, Tell them that their sins I cover, and their warfare now is over.
Hear these words as we depart this place of worship and go out into the world to serve our God. May the living Christ go with you, before you to light the way, behind you to guide you, beside you to befriend you, beneath you to sustain you, above you to watch over you, and within you to give you peace. Go and serve God faithfully. Amen.
Rejoice, rejoice.